Our next presentation will be given by Ms. Ratna Prabha Manikavachakam. Prabha is the Managing Director and she heads the Innovation and Digital Transformation at Societe Generale Global Solutions Center. I have a fairly long bio that I have with me for Prabha, but I just want to highlight a few points and give the floor as quickly as I can to her. So I believe Prabha has been with Societe Generale for over 10 years now, and she has held various strategic IT delivery positions, including head of risk, referential and finance IT, head of client trading technologies, and so on and so forth. And before that, again, a fairly long illustrious career. So instead of taking the time away from her, let me pass the floor to Prabha. Prabha, you're on.
Thank you. I hope you're fully audible. I'm audible, right?
You're a little feeble.
Is it? Could,
okay. If there's a way to increase the volume, that'd be great.
Yes, we'll do that. Okay, I think I should be good now.
Yes, much better. Thank you.
All right. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be with all of you today to share my thoughts on how BFSI has greatly benefited from the usage of data and financial analytics. I take this moment, I'm reminded about a case study on Bajaj Finance done by Saurav Mukherjee. I was thrilled to see one of our own Indian companies, Bajaj Finance, enjoying monopoly in the NBFC space due to its right usage of analytics. That got me thinking, and on further research, I think it was very interesting to understand the use case that I think will set the tone for this presentation. I do not have a presentation, so it's going to be a lot of listening for you guys. So, Bajaj Finance, like other NBFCs, is an NBFC, like Cholamandalam, Shriram Transport, HDFC, etc. But the key differentiator is the usage of technology, which makes them more of a technology business. Their fundamental insight was, if you want to make a lot of money in lending business, you have to be able to do the basic function 10x better than anyone else. The basic function of a lender is to be able to assess credit risk better than anybody else. So what did they do to make credit risk, credit assessment 10 times better than their competitors? So they figured out the answer about 12, 13 years ago in 2008, I believe. They collected a lot of data, I would say more data than anybody else, on about 400 million affluent Indians than their competitors. How they did it, of course, is through a lot of data collection agencies that are available in the market. They use these data insights to identify profit opportunities. I think that is a very important step that they took. There are big pools of low-risk borrowers in India who others thought were high-risk, and Bajaj Finance looked at some of these data and they took at the first opportunity that they spotted was doctors and dentists as a pool. There are about 10 lakh doctors in India. Since they are mostly self-employed, conventional lenders charge them higher interest rates. Bajaj's analytics told them that doctors' cash flows are stable and they're low risk than other white-collared employees in other industries. The CIBIL score, of course, hadn't figured it out yet. But Bajaj Finance's data collection and analytics showed them this opportunity very, very clearly. They took the big plunge based on this data. The volume is going down. So when they looked at this opportunity, it was very important for them to research it in detail. They went back and forth and offered doctors of our country the lowest interest rate ever offered by any NBFC. That helped them collect a lot of data. Once they created a strong doctor book in the country, they motivated it to use the second layer of analytics that they were ready with by that time. They stratified their doctor book into 600 risk buckets. If a doctor studied, let's say, in a top medical school or top 20 medical schools like AIIMS, JIPMER, etc., then the doctor is put in a better risk bucket. If he or she is an oncologist, as an example, versus a cosmetologist or a cosmetic surgeon, then again, the doctor gets a better risk bucket. If his or her clinic is set up in, let's say, Jayanagar 4th block or Indranagar of Bangalore versus a Shimoga or a Hasan in Karnataka, then again, he or she gets a better risk bucket. In essence, if the doctor is from an All India Medical Institute, is an oncologist whose clinic is set up in, let's say, Jayanagar, he or she gets Bajaj Finance's best possible rate. On the other hand, the cosmetic surgeon from another regional university practicing in Shivoga gets a higher rate. By doing this, Bajaj turned its doctor book into a book with very high barrier of entry, creating a very niche monopoly for themselves with this pool of low-risk acquisition. Now, the whole doctor financing, they would like, they took it to a different level, and companies, for example, in this case, Chola, in my example, won't have this data at the outset. So they will offer an average rate, even if they would like to enter the doctor's financing business. Now, the oncologist in Jayanagar will not go to Chola because of the low rates offered by Bajaj, but at the same time, the cosmetic surgeon in Shimoga would. So Chola's entry will further purify Bajaj's book on this kind of selection they have made and the low rates that they have provided. Once they nailed the doctor market Tesla style or an Amazon style, they moved on to replicate this with chartered accountants, lawyers, and architects. Today, they have the largest book of white-collar self-employed loans in our country, which I think is a very proud moment for all of us to look at our own company in India who has made this difference a few years back. The bigger banks, of course, have been using it for a while for a variety of purposes, but small NBFCs and becoming bigger by usage of analytics was not very well known, you know, 12 or 13 years ago. I would like to take this research a step further by also talking about, after accomplishing this, they went to the second layer of motive. They were confident of their usage of analytics. They went to high street retailers like Croma in 2015 and offered to finance consumer goods for their customers. And most local Croma, they got a space set up for their desk at every Croma center. So Bajaj got cracking in white goods financing and electronics financing as well. But when you look at who got most of this business, there were other competitors as well in the same store, but 90% of these local electronic store financing business goes to Bajaj, even now, not only because they're aggressive, but their turnaround time of these consumer loans took only 2 minutes due to their very strong analytics backbone. They only use PAN number and address to figure out good credit, but I think their systems were extremely prepared to handle the two minute approvals. The rivals take 2 days or more to take credit decisions, and which was to the advantage of Bajaj. The most fascinating part is that once Bajaj lends to you and you start repaying your TV EMI, let's say for 3 to 4 months, Bajaj cross sells to you every other financial product, and they refinance your car loan, home loan, and every other loan. The consumer durables financing is a business development engine for Bajaj financing. At zero cost, they grab the best credits in the country and they use that loan to validate that XYZ person with PAN card number so and so and address is a good credit, and they acquired this entire set of customers at zero cost. This, ladies and gentlemen, is a first-class demonstration of one of the best use cases in our BFSI for financial analytics, which is customer acquisition and customer retention. Bajaj Finance practices this at scale and has very reliable data analytics practices. The most relevant and common financial data analytics practices across the BFSI industry, usually, you know, the famous five, as we call. We'll quickly talk about that as well. So on the customer acquisition, we just spoke about customer acquisition and retention from a Bajaj perspective. We will take a few other examples to illustrate how our industry has, gained by usage of financial analytics. So the banks can develop real-time insights into individual prospects and personalized engagement by investing in financial analytics tools, of course. The actionable and accurate insights gained will help generate interest in own products and services on a customer-by-customer basis, which is a very important thing that today banks are able to go at a customer level, individual customer level, retail or investment banking, and improve customer segmentation, which is a real capability that financial analytics has provided. For example, Citibank is a very strong advocate of data-led analytical approach and often experiments with innovative use cases of analytics by deconstructing data. One primary use case is customer acquisition and retention. A Citibank has analyzed its customer data. I think this is available in the public forum. They analyzed its customer data with machine learning algorithms and used this analysis to target promotional spending, which is one of the largest implementation of this technology. With analytics, we explore historical performance, for example, in our bank, of new customers, measure campaign effectiveness whenever you conduct specific campaign in certain markets or on certain products, estimate the potential value of each customer, which is a capability that financial analytics has provided us banks, estimate price sensitivity and personalized acquisition offers. So all of this, I think, you know, we usually bucket it under the customer acquisition umbrella, but typically all of these activities require specific analytics team to look at all the data lakes that concern customer data and prepare all of this for the use of the teams concerned with sales and ones that deal with customer acquisition. The second big segment of usage in the BFSI is customer retention, right? As you see, as you saw in the use case example of Bajaj Finance, that they have come up with low cost strategy for customer retention, but usually the cost of customer retention is much higher for us than the customer and the cost of acquisition. Therefore, it is important to solidify the relationship by meeting and exceeding expectations every single time. The lifetime value of a customer can be maximized only by developing an effective customer retention strategy. And that, I think, banks have understood this extremely well in the competitive space that we are in. This would really turn banks into profitable and turn banks into profitable entities and also get us a loyal banking customer. In order to achieve this objective, banks need to assess the customer's economic value, behavior patterns, preferred service channel, customer attrition level, and most of all, feedback. So all of this usually is in the unstructured space of data space, and getting all of these elements together to make meaningful and to take meaningful insights is a complete analytics game. But running predictive analytics on these elements, we identify silent attrition, happens all the time, and dissatisfied customers and create strategies to tackle the situation. With analytics insights, we can roll out preventive measures for customer retention and reduce attrition and dissatisfaction. As easily as it is told, it is extremely important for long-term customers to benefit from usage, from adding new products and being beneficiaries of every new step that the bank takes. So I'll give you an example. American Express serves as a great example of how to forecast potential churn and localize strategies to retain customers. Again, this is a well-known case study. The global financial services company, American Express in this case, relies on big data tools and techniques to empower business decision makers to act locally, which is extremely important because it's a large global organization. To empower business decisions locally was an extremely important step on local customer retention. American Express also analyzed cardholder spending patterns to provide customized offers that helped largely to retain customers. Analytical-driven targeted marketing allows American Express to match the right customers with the right merchants, resulting in loyal and profitable customer base, as they say. The company is also able to predict a possible churn with a lot of new entrants designing new card products and offers, and which helps them design marketing strategies to convert their existing customers into loyal customers. The third big use case for BFSI is the fraud analysis. According to KPMG, which I think was a survey that they published in 2019, external fraud increased and continues to increase at a 20% rate every year, both in value and volume. As a result, fraud detection and prevention is a top priority of banks. I mean, this is a no-brainer that it is definitely one of the most highest priority for every bank to save itself from customer fraud and other types of fraud. Advanced analytics has replaced the manual process which banks followed. Right now, they use automated data-driven technology to monitor transactions and activities to detect fraud. Fraud is extremely a creative space for fraudsters. So if you have to stay not two steps anymore, 10 steps above the fraudsters, then identifying transaction irregularities is extremely important in advanced stage, even before the transaction happens. So by identifying transaction irregularities and dubious activities using customer data, analytical tools can flag and investigate financial crimes like fraud, money laundering, and criminal financing activities. Predictive analytics is a huge player in the space in the solution side. It also helps banks to study customer behavior. I think there's a lot of behavioral study, the data regarding behaviors that come into the picture that helps identify suspicious activities and protect accounts against repeated cyber attacks. For example, in Societe Generale, we've put together a dedicated team of data scientists to work on anti-money laundering, embargo, and sanction-related predictive analysis. The analysis helps reduce pre-processing times, as we call, because there's a lot of data collection. There's a lot of data that hit the analysts during the pre-processing cycle. And of course, the post-processing volumes due to false positives is extremely high. So that increases the volume of processing, I would say, week after week, month after month. Elaborate solutions on fraud detection analysis has helped us introduce a lot of automation in the pre-processing stage. And predictive analytics, analytical models have been built that help build accuracy to a great extent. And it's also our endeavor not to invest too much into fraud detection while doing it extremely effectively. And for this, I think we make usage of a lot of ML models. Of course, we have global teams, the operations team, extremely alert on fraudulent transactions. At the same time, the technology that we use is the key differentiator that is helping us detect these fraudulent transactions and save the bank and the customer. The fourth space, which is extremely important and interesting, is the credit risk analysis. I think every bank would agree that today there is a lot of risk for the banks after providing those huge loans, which is important for the economic development. At the same time, banks need to safeguard their own interests. But this credit risk analysis is a huge space that banks invest in. Internal external fraud combined with market volatility and customer default, which happens in time frame, makes the banks and financial services vulnerable to a number of risks. Therefore, risk management plays a crucial role in minimizing risk exposure and protecting the value of its assets. And this is a real-time activity in most banks right now. It is no more an activity that happens cyclically. According to Deloitte, regulatory reform is one of the three main drivers behind the wide adoption of advanced analytics in banking when it comes to risk analysis. Besides managing and spending a lot on operational risk, market risk, and liquidity risk, which is important for the banks, banks now, I think since at least past 7 or 8 years, use big data and analytical techniques to strengthen their credit risk management process. The process itself is extremely complex. Simplifying these processes using advanced technology is a must if we are going to take it real time. And you can imagine the volumes that needs to be processed on a daily basis or even much earlier, I mean, even more frequently. While we have listed the use cases for external fraud detection, financial organizations can eliminate risk at the customer acquisition and retention stage itself because it's strong KYC helps by evaluating new customer account. That is where the KYC is extremely linked to the financial analytics and the data crosses the boundaries in most banks between the KYC domain and credit risk domain. We don't need high risk customers. No bank needs high risk customers, even if you're profitable in the beginning. So the factors that advanced data analytics can really help determine in the credit risk analysis space is the new account was created by furnishing, let's say, false information that is detected. The likelihood of a customer defaulting on a loan product, this is again very basic, but it's extremely important that it's detected. And the expected value at risk from potential customer loss. So even without customer loss, the expected value at risk is something that is calculated, and it is a big determining factor for a lot of decision making. Lastly, cross-selling. Banks are able to boost cross-selling and upselling opportunities of their products and services with predictive analytics. With access to information about customer behavior at a granular level, banks can prepare hyper-personalized strategies, which would normally it would be a highly strenuous task in the absence of advanced analytics. For example, banks can not only measure the effectiveness of cross-selling campaigns by conducting a win-loss data analysis, which is the trend now, but also anticipate acceptance rate for future cross-selling initiatives, which typically it's also dependent on customer segments. Yes Bank is a great example whose big data analytical use cases received global recognition at the Gartner Excellence Awards. His bank uses advanced analytics and data science techniques to map the customer life cycle to obtain insights into customer behavior. And that is a large setup and a very successful setup that is giving them a lot of important insights for decision making. They use these insights for their marketing and cross-selling campaigns and portfolio management. So quickly now, I would also like to, how much time do I have, Raj?
Yeah, about 10 minutes more. We have in total 20 minutes. So if you can take 10 minutes more speaking, we'll have 10 minutes for 20.
Sure. I just wanted to touch upon our SG GSC, the Societe Generale Global Solutions Center's connection with the Robert Bosch AI Center within IIT Madras, and the collaborations that we have done on financial analytics for the past 2.5 to 3 years, specifically with a few professors, Nandan Sudarshanam, Amit, Professor Amit, Professor Tenmori, and others who have helped us greatly and intently listen to our use cases, business cases, and provide us very effective solutions. I'll give you a few examples of how we have worked with the center predominantly. We have an internal startup called AskCashberry, who's now live in South Africa, providing its wallet-based digital wallet services in Africa. And in the beginning, I think before going live in the African market, we talked to Professor Nandan and asked him to help us with creation of trust algorithm and how to ensure that there's trust between the users who transact. I think for any new player to enter a new market, it was very important. We did not have the experience of Societe Generale to build trust algorithm. And this is where the experience of our IIT partners came into the picture to determine the parameters that would constitute to the robust trust index, which they did after elaborate research. They came up with that. And the algorithm was tested and integrated to the AskCashberry's mobile app, which today is live in the South African market. A big thank you to IIT for that. We also took Professor Amit Arke's help to do the pricing model itself, because there are multiple pricing models that that are given to customers in Africa. To arrive at the various pricing models, the business team could choose pricing based on the client nature. And we took help to create a simulator that the business team could use to arrive at various pricing methods instantly for customers. I think the turnaround time that these models have given us a huge competitive advantage in Africa. And again, that is something that we are too grateful for, Professor Amit. And also, we also, before rolling AskCashberry out, we looked at means to measure the liquidity in the market, because we were going to roll this as a commercial tool in the retail market. So we worked with the governmental setups like IBA to evangelize the application with Indian banking networks in the beginning. And then Professor Tenmori has helped us providing advisory and consulting guidance, matters pertaining to regulation and compliance, which is very important, especially because Societe Generale doesn't work in the Indian space so much from a retail angle. So it's very important that we get this advisory and consulting guidance before we set up this tool, and it has greatly helped AskCashberry as well. I would also like to touch upon the help that we received from Professor Nandan on three other use cases, one on a bond pricing algorithm, which is a very important use case for us to study different types of bonds that are valued in the primary market and provide a standard valuation of trading prices, which I think it was a great algorithm that we developed. And then we also have something called as knowledge graphs, which is where we provide descriptive visual insights on the interdependencies between the various relationships and properties of the accounting value chain. Therefore, the prioritization of processes itself happens visually based on the insight and the interdependency, and that is a very dynamic way of determining the priority that each of these knowledge graphs provide us, and that was also done with. And the last and the most important activity that we are working with currently is on the suspicious activities detection. We have built a supervised model detecting the SAR directly from the basic client data like KYC accounts, transactions. And to develop this from the 360 degree client information database and the information of the SAR already created, it was important for us to provide all this data and take back the models. And the model, of course, has demonstrated its conceptual soundness. We have tested it for data quality impact and sensitivity analysis, and the model has gone through the stress test. And I think we've had a very successful engagement with IIT Madras on some of these financial analytics activity that we perform with external help. I would say a lot of activities performed inside with our own data scientists and ML AI teams, but there is quite a significant amount of activity where we seek the help of the best minds and help and reduce the time to market. So this is what was planned for the day. So thank you so much. I can take some questions.
Thanks, Prabha. Thank you for a very comprehensive presentation. You started with, I think you alluded all the way from A and B, Amex and Bajaj all the way to Y, Yes Bank. I missed a Z. I don't know if you mentioned a Z anywhere, but it looks like it's an A to Z presentation almost. You touched on a number of topics and we have a few questions coming in, but to kind of set the stage going, let me first invite all participants who have any questions, comments, or clarifications to for Prabha to post them either on the Q&A box in Zoom or to post them on the YouTube chat box. We will try to take up as many of them as we can in the available time. So the first question, Prabha, that I would like to feature to you is related to model risks, specifically issues around models going rogue. Would you care to comment on that aspect?
Yes, I think models going rogue, before that, I think, models need to keep learning. So no model is perfect, of course. There are models and every other model that's developed in the market goes through a lot of testing. Only a model is as good as its data. So even if 10 million records are provided during the testing process, 11th million record could completely make it fail. So that is where the feedback to the model and constant monitoring of the model. That is why usually models don't replace humans completely. There is a channel of appreciation that we have for the analysts who do the final checks and capture before models go completely, and provide the feedback and correct it with the right amount of data, and keep training the models. Usually deep learning models are better to deploy in this step.
Okay, the next question that I see here relates to best practices in terms of hyper-personalized offerings. Are there certain do's and don'ts that one should be mindful of when trying to develop these kinds of hyper-personalized offerings?
So hyper-personalized offerings succeed only based on, it's as good as the customer's behavior or as good as we have understood the customer behavioral pattern. What it says is, again, the feedback loop from the customer side is extremely important. The rate of success of deployment of hyper-personalized strategies usually to begin with meets a certain amount of resistance from the customer side, and that's for good reasons. And that's also part of the behavior that we study. And with the hyper-personalized strategy, there is a lot of customers who actually appreciate in the online world things that are done for them on a personal basis. And then there are a lot of customers who like to follow the standard models. So if you have to come to a balance and see and understand the customer, and when you're dealing with millions of customers, it's impossible to scale out and roll hyper-personalized without the help of technology. So a lot of people rely on the information that our analytical systems provide to deploy it, and then rely on feedback that comes from the customers and the actual feedback on the ground to further you know, modernize it and further deploy it. But I think all of this is extremely important because experimentation is something that customers do like. And if there's something that customers do not like, actually hyper-personalization actually takes care of it. So it is usually successful in 70 to 75% of the cases, at least with the current generation of people that banks are dealing with.
So here's a question about some of the recent changes which have happened in the last year, given the global pandemic and so on. There have been a number of changes, I presume, in customer behaviors. So what challenges do these kind of abrupt changes pose to data-driven models, where previous trends pre-COVID may not continue on in this new era?
Absolutely. I think starting with the channels on which customers could be reached earlier, on the channels where they responded, everything has changed post-COVID. So for all the digital reliance that we had, our digital dependence has started post-COVID. For example, within the French region where we operate intensely, we had to deploy a lot of digital advisory services on priority for our customers to take advantage of. And we also realized that a lot of opportunity existed, which we did not tap into which I think the data insights gave us a lot of opportunity analysis details. And I think once we took advantage of that, it's not only us, I think many banks have been able to deploy, I would say, a lot of new digitally mature services, use a lot of collaborative channels on the open banking side where you collaborate with other players in the market to provide very intuitive collective services instead of inventing everything on your own, go with other players and provide a full suite of 360 degree services to customers. That gave a lot of market advantage, especially while entering new markets. And I think the pandemic has had its own share of woes where a lot of credit and loans had to be deployed very urgently with the governments, and many governments supported as underlying, surety for these loans. But I think deployment of loans was also a huge responsibility that banks took up, especially Société Générale in the French geographical space. But I think everybody did their part to help at the same time, which this also means that the data that we had on high-risk customers, on the credit risk analysis, almost had to be completely redone and fresh customer data collection had to be done. So all of these posed a lot of challenges. But I think the response from the banks are pretty credible and pretty impressive. Because the preparation, I think this industry, actually the BFSI industry, was quite prepared because the digital nature of the customers had already brought in all of these solutions. Some of the solutions were in nascent stage, but in terms of productionizing them and taking them up to full scale was done during the pandemic because the pandemic offered these opportunities.
Excellent. So, and just as a follow-up to that, so since the pandemic has evolved somewhat differently across geographical borders, do companies face some specific further challenges that certain geographies are able to do things that other geographies are not able to?
Actually, it's a myth because Société Générale, for example, is present across 21 countries in Africa as well. And it was by surprise on the countries in certain continents which did not go through, the debit card and the credit card phase of digitization that the other advanced and developed countries went through, are completely into mobile and digital banking. And the speed at which it was adopted, even in the rural areas, is amazing. And I think the governments have a huge role to play in encouraging people to reach out and spend digitally and reduce the cash outflow and the cash inflow has anyway reduced during the pandemic. So the digital channels and training people to use the digital technology, especially the mobile-based technologies and the apps and usage of services and offers and products completely in a digital format, has reduced the challenges, the continued challenges, and gave opportunities to a lot of new NBFCs to come up, a lot of new services come up. And the microservices is also a huge hit now in the banking space. And the overall response from the market to the challenge in terms of accepting a lot of new solutions. Actually, that is the thing to appreciate, or what is fascinating is there was a lot of solutions thrown at people at the same time. A lot of innovation in the digital transformation space concerning customers has risen, I would say, at least 20 to 25% in 1 year. And when customers are open-minded to experiment, to really accept these solutions, figure out the usage, invest using these solutions, spend using these solutions, these apps, and encourage the providers to, Paytm is a great example, what Paytm was 2 years ago to it's a complete, it's the set of banking products they have is amazing when you see them today. And all of this is for the customer usage. And if the customers did not encourage the usage of Paytm or the competitors in the market today, they would be nowhere. And they're all huge profit-making entities today. And that vouches for the acceptance in the market.
I wish we had more time, but I think we are almost out of time. So I'm going to ask the last question. And this is possibly from a student who is interested in figuring out if, as a student, if you want to get your hand on real or perhaps even realistic data, where can they, get it and, so that they can develop more cutting edge new technologies?
I think the data sharing policies of banks to protect their customer data is extremely stringent. I think the only space to play in, most of the banks today have collaborative sandboxes that they have built that they provide to startups. We provide that, where you give a combination of publicly available data and some of the what we call as C0 or the not so important data for developmental purposes to startups. And this type of data is available in the sandbox environment, and they're available in collaborative open banking environments where many players come and test their products, services to offer it to multiple, to cross-sell it to other customers. These are well-known public data spaces to play with where banks also provide their data. But it is almost impossible to get hold of real customer data because banks protect it heavily.
Okay. So thank you, Prabha. That was a vast coverage of a large number of topics you touched upon. I'm sure all our participants would have gained a lot from your insights. I believe there are still a number of questions out there on both on the YouTube chat and on our Zoom chat. Perhaps if we could take a couple of minutes to respond to them, that would be great.
I do not have the link for the YouTube chat, but
We will send it to you.
All right.
So,
thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you, Prabha. Thank you so much.
For patient listening. All right.